And to know more about the business and art collection investment, which I am actually very excited to find out, we will discuss it with Kevin Raharjo. Whereas he and his family has been in the business for more than 19 years.
Yes, thank you so much for having me.
Wow, you know, I see this in movies. I've always wanted to know about art history, art curation. A couple of my favorite historical fictions always involve art pieces. But can you tell me more, please, about the investment of painting, specifically here in Indonesia?
Yes, so I just speak with your colleague also that investment in art is always a unique one because it's like a combination of a high brand and property side of it, because each of the unique painter only have one of one painting, each painting, right? I mean, so if the painter only work on one painting and then you to recreate it again, it cannot be the same, right? So it's unique, only one of one painting. And I guess the next segment is you're gonna ask like, how is the value maybe, right? Like, I mean, the from that point, if it's a unique painting and also added to it is the history of the painting itself. That's what make it a unique. So combination, right? Like property is unique, only one place, one, and then high fashion value because they have a long history. And that's, I think, the unique part of painting is a combination.
So it's a combination of property and also the artistic value.
Yes.
But we're also talking about history. What are the characteristics that makes a painting worth investing in?
So if you talk about the painting in general, the brand is the artist. So we need to understand that. So when you are investing, you need to know the history of the artist, the history of the brand. And the value comes derived from the artist's history. If, for example, in Indonesia, is we know Afandi is the one who created a painting directly from the tube. So he's actually the one who invented that. So that's each of his painting is very valuable. And besides that, it's also the painter that have a good value knows that he needs to create a strong, identifiable, unique perspective. So when you see in a museum, you know from like from anywhere, oh, this is the painter, this is him or this is her. You know, I guess the combination about it.
So how much does the increasing rate percentage of a painting is owned by someone?
It depends. So, but statistically, if you Google it or search, the old master, we call it the old master, like Picasso and Rembrandt, things like that, is always 30% is the minimal increasing rate per annually. Right, and you can see this, most of the popular artists right now can gain like 100% annually or more than that even.
So what, my question is this. So there's a lot of history involved, obviously. If you are, if you want to start, you know, this kind of investment, you really have to know your art history. At least you have to know the artist that you're investing in. So what are usually the differences on, how do you measure these, you know, returns on, and on, you know, the, you know, the percentage hikes every year, basically, and on an annual basis, because sometimes, as you've seen, it has to be unique, but sometimes a painting can be valued more within 6 months than it was the month before, just like stock exchanges. Because in stock exchanges, we know the world's, okay, economy makes a factor. What factors, you know, what factors would count into price changes in paintings as an investment?
Yes, that's a good point, actually. Economy is always the same because we call this the hobby market. Economy is always playing a role in that. But the difference is because we're talking about emotional value added, because when you see a painting, usually this, or we want to buy a painting, we have an emotional attachment to it. So whatever the situation is, if they saw an opportunity and they like, or they like the painting really much, they're going to buy, like everyone going to buy. So I think the value is not, we cannot quantify it like the economy or other outside stuff, but actually it's just the market itself is not reflecting. So it depends really on the individual at that time. Because sometimes they really like a certain painting, then they just wanna buy.
You know? That's why you find it in auctions more, right?
Yes.
Because it's a different emotional value to one person than the next.
Yes,
so
exactly.
So you cannot really pinpoint a market value for a painting like this. I completely understand, but talk to me about the market in Indonesia. You mentioned before it was a hobby market, right?
Yes.
So talk to me about the interest and what paintings are Indonesian curators or Indonesian collectors very interested in? International works, or are there some of Indonesian works that are perhaps top five that are very highly valued?
Yes, that's right. Actually, Indonesian painters is actually really, really well known in the worldwide. In the Southeast Asia, especially region, we are actually number three, the most expensive painting in Indonesia ever sold in the world. But sorry, your question is about which painters, right? In Indonesia, we call it the old master. Mm-hmm. There's the top five is Afandi, Liman Fong, Hendra Gunawan, S. Sujoyono, and Basuki Abdullah. This is the father that pushed forward the modern Indonesian painting, actually. There's always on demand, the price is always rising up year to year, and that. And now the artist of pop art is also keeping a pace with the newer generation. Like now the newer generation is looking for a more colorful era, a pop art, a street art, you know, and this now is in competition of the painters. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, from Indonesia there's a lot also like outside, like cows. So it's a very competitive market in terms of the newer generation. But still, the blue chip is the old master.
So what I've always wanted to know is, because you have been, your family has been in this business for 19 years, so you curate and you not just curate, but you also, how do you say, determine the value of a painting. What is the process like? So what is the process of finding a painting and valuing it and, you know, pushing it forward to the market?
Yeah, so I will talk about maybe a business perspective first. So we play with the data, of course. We search from our company also, because we have 19 years of data, and then with the reason which price, and we compare it to, of course, another sources, a lot of sources we compare. That's one thing. But the second thing is also we do a lot of not trial and error, but in auction we put, for example, starting bid from 10 million, but it can achieve to 50 million. So that means the market price is 50 million.
Yeah.
Or vice versa, we put it like 20 million, but no one's wanna do that. So the market price may be a bit lower. So we do like a bit of a trial and error also.
Well, yeah, because the auction is the only way we can really determine the sentimental value that the people have towards this particular art. I get it. Because there's less black and white data, like when we're talking about stocks, bonds, and the economic market, of course. Yeah. But, you know, my other question would be, due to financial crisis, is there any difference in value of the investments of painting specifically? Did it actually go up, or are we experiencing a couple of devaluations?
Yes, so I just actually read a market valuation about art, and the, like I said, the blue chip stocks or like the blue chip painters, they actually picking up pace, like 30% increase, 20% increase. I think it's because they know it's time to buy. It's always like that, right? The price is still lower and people want to sell it any price, so they just keep buying. But I see there's a lot of new artists, emerging artists we call it, it's also hard to them for now.
Yeah.
Because usually people, they want to buy because they love it, but now due to financial crisis, they think a little bit different. But they still want to buy, but maybe just maybe a few months later on, you know, they hold back a bit. Not as like before, like 2018 and 16 or previously. It's actually the emerging artists saw a very, very good period like that. And the 2020 is a bit slowing down, but they're still a good choice.
So if I summarize this correctly, investors are now a little bit more cautious, if you mean.
Yeah.
So they're investing more in the blue chip, you know, and the blue chip painters, because they're the value that are more secure, because we don't know when it's the emerging artist if their value is going to go up. How does it determine? Let's say like this. How does an emerging artist from, like, just say this is an artist A, just released first painting. How does he get to value up over time? Is it the painting of his quality, or is it like a specific moment in history, something happened? What is the determiner of the factors that comes to that?
So there's actually two part of it. The first part is this artist need to have, like I said, a strong, unique point. For example, it's from the color, they only use this certain color or certain shape, like Picasso, right? And if people can easily identify, then people want to buy it because it's unique, easily, right? Like a brand. And the second thing is, this artist need to do a lot of exhibition. So they got out there, and now it's an online exhibition. There's a lot of online exhibition, art fairs, and a lot of organizer, right? Mm-hmm. They need to approach that artist, usually through galleries and through museums that have exhibition. And I think they need to get out there. That's the only way to people to see is to follow that, I guess, and build their resume, right? If I may, that people ask them for exhibitions and they sold there, or that increased their market value from there.
Can I just, out of curiosity, ask you one question?
Sure.
How big is the hobby industry or commodity investment market here in Indonesia valued in rupiah or in dollars?
It's actually really big. In Hong Kong, there's an auction, right?
Yep.
Indonesian painter always sold above 8 billion.
8 billion?
8 billion, yes.
How? That's rupiah.
That's rupiah.
Okay.
Yes, rupiah.
Okay.
So it's really, really big, actually.
Mm-hmm.
That's not mentioning like the really unique painting, hundreds, billions, and everything. So it's really huge, actually, the market.
Wow. So if I am a new, a novice when it comes to painting investment, what are the tips that you would give me before I start investing in my first painting?
Okay, so this actually maybe not a conventional one, but I always said if you want to invest in painting, you need to find what you like first. Mm-hmm. What type of painting? For example, you like sceneries, you like a war painting or something. So to do that, you need to go to museum, art fair, because this is something that you need to enjoy first and foremost.
Okay.
Without thinking about the value first, you need to enjoy which one, because you're going to see it. You're going to put it in your house or in your office, right? So you need to really enjoy it first. And then the second part is you find the brand. Mm-hmm. After you enjoy a certain painting, for example, I like this pop art. And then you try to research a bit, which artist emerging one, or which artist embodies the pop art, have a lot of histories. And then, and then you put in that artist.
Mm-hmm.
And then you buy that artist, I mean.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, that's certainly an eye-opener for me, because not only do you get to invest in luxury bags, but you also get to invest in paintings. Okay, how young are the investors these days?
Oh, yeah, this is a unique one. After the 2020, because there's a lot of content creators, online work, now the youngest is 30, 25. They are thinking about buying painting. Actually, they bought, not thinking.
At what value?
Some goes like 50 million.
Wow.
This is a new one, I mean.
Uh-huh.
You know, like they don't know, they don't do research, they don't do, they come and then they want to buy up to 50 to 80.
They just want to keep something 50 million hoarded in an investment. That's
yes, exactly.
Wow.
So it's really interesting now.
Mm.
Yeah.
Wow. I think it's because more and more content creators are earning more and more money and looking at ways to differentiate and, you know, diversify their portfolios, because we know that stocks are great, but they're not the most conventional, and people these days don't think conventional, right?
Yeah.
It's a trend.
It's a trend, yeah.
It's a trend. Well, any last advice that you have for anybody who wants to start or is already in painting investor?
I think the most important is you need to enjoy it first, because this is something that I always remind them, don't put your money like you don't enjoy, because you want to just throw it out right away. Like, come on, make this money, make go up, the price go up. But this is something you need to emotionally attach first, and then when you enjoy it, you don't care for the value, and then suddenly 1 year, it increased like 50%, 30%.
Mm.
I think that's the most advice I can give.
Do you think the sentimental attachment you have towards that piece of art can also be a factor to the change in price the year after?
Yeah, definitely.
Really?
Definitely. Because you don't want to sell, like, for example, you really like this painting, right? You bought it a certain value and you don't really want to sell it any value, right? If you like it, because this is your prized possession, something like that. So yeah, it's definitely a factor also.
Wow. Interesting. Well, it's definitely something to think about, because it's certainly an interesting trend that is definitely happening here in Indonesia. And we do have a lot of great painters here in Indonesia as well, emerging and senior ones, who, as mentioned before, are very, very popular worldwide and especially in the region. So that might be an option for you to consider as well. Those were the economics and business updates we have for you in this hour. And when we return, Yani will bring the latest from the sports world. So make sure to stay tuned with us from the RNA Show on C today.